Hello, Psyche community. This is Dr. Fatima Tadat, Medical Science Liaison for Otsuka Pharmaceutical Development and Commercialization Incorporated, and I'm joined here today with Dr. Mona Sabani. Dr. Sabani is Director of Research and Operations at USC Center for Body Computing. Her research studies have included investigating the relationship between health outcomes and technology, including wearable devices and mobile apps. Dr. Sabani holds a PhD in neuroscience from USC and a postdoc from Vanderbilt University. Today, we are here to discuss privacy and security in digital health. So let's dive right in. Dr. Sabani?
Thank you, Fatima. It's great to be here with you today talking about this timely topic. We'll kick this off starting with privacy and security of health information and HIPAA. We're seeing in the modern age a significant increase in the use of digital tools in medicine, and this talk is timely because this is especially true with the current COVID-19 public health crisis, where there is an emphasis on social distancing to reduce the spread of the virus. So subsequently, many physician visits have been moved online. Included in that, digital technologies are improving access to mental health care, but as with anything digital, there are risks, so we must be careful to protect personal health information and maintain public trust. The reason this is important is because there has been a significant increase in data hacks in general, but also specifically in healthcare. Between 2009 and 2019, more than 3,000 healthcare data breaches occurred in the US, resulting in the theft or exposure of over 230 million healthcare records. That's a lot. And more than 69% of Americans, they may have had their healthcare data exposed. Additionally, in 2015, about 113 million records were exposed, and detected incidents of hacking and unauthorized access, they've greatly increased between 2010 and 2019. So there's a lot of evidence for the insecurity of digital data, and in particular, healthcare digital data. So the public acceptance and large-scale utilization of health technology may be unlikely unless steps are taken to protect personal health information and allow patients to feel safe. Digital data aside, the protection of personal health information generally is governed by a federal law, the Health Information Portability and Accountability Act of 1996, or HIPAA for short. It establishes standards and safeguards for maintaining personal health information through its privacy and security rules. The security rule is designed to be flexible and scalable to assist in the adoption of new technologies for the improvement of care. The safeguards that it outlines include three levels of protection. So it's administrative, physical, and technical. Administrative includes managing security personnel and training the workforce on security policies and procedures. Physical includes protection around who has physical access to the information. So this governs physical protections around accessing facilities and workstations. Technical safeguard refers to the technical protection of the information and includes managing and monitoring access to the data. Interestingly, HIPAA only applies to what are called covered entities, which include HCPs who transmit health information in an electronic form, health plans, healthcare clearinghouses, because historically these were the entities that were most likely to have detailed personal health information. And then actual implementation of these policies vary from place to place. We'll move on to some of the tools used in digital mental health and the privacy and security of those tools. Telepsychiatry is the process of providing mental health care from a distance through the use of technology, such as video conferencing, which is a very popular option. It's a convenient option for patients and providers. It alleviates transportation barriers. You don't have to look for parking. It's very convenient and it's great. However, both clinicians and patients have voiced concerns over privacy and security, worried about PHI from the sessions being intercepted by outside parties. Some concerns around that include, is the network secure? Are patients taking calls in public spaces where their session can be overheard? You'll hear stories of patients using public spaces for these sessions, like libraries. So there's no guarantee that it's private and secure. So to help address some of these concerns, the APA and ATA published Best Practices Guide for Video Conferences for Telemental Health in 2018 that included security recommendations for telepsychiatry technology, that included ensuring that audio and video transmissions are encrypted, that devices use security features such as two-factor authentication and passphrases, and that devices are up to date on security, antivirus, and firewall software. The guidelines also included other considerations for users of these services, such as making sure they're following all federal and health privacy laws, including HIPAA, using video conferencing platforms with appropriate verification, confidentiality, and security parameters, enacting policies and procedures to ensure devices are physically and electronically secure, and ensuring privacy of locations of patients and providers, as I mentioned briefly on the previous slide as well. So it's important to choose platforms based on their policies that align with these considerations. Moving on to health IT. Health IT comprises the electronic systems that HCPs and patients use to store, share, and analyze health-related information, such as EHRs. Obviously, cybersecurity is very important and is a necessity for the protection of EHRs. There's a few key ways that cybercrime can be committed on health IT. So one of these is called cryptographic attacks, which basically attempts to breach the encrypted files. This is usually extremely targeted. Another example is malware installation. This can steal information or take over a computer system. Oftentimes, they can be inadvertently downloaded through email, or if you click a link or download a file, that's how it can get on your system. And the third example is denial of service attacks, which aim to shut down access to a service. In accordance with HIPAA requirements, many safeguarding practices have been studied to protect patient health information. Frequently studied and utilized security techniques, as I previously mentioned, include firewalls and cryptography. So firewalls are a great way they can block unauthorized internal and external connections to a health system network. Cryptography involves the use of health record encryption and decryption using digital signatures, so that somebody without the digital signatures won't be able to access the files. So it's a very secure way to protect the data. And usernames and passwords to prevent unauthorized access and control what information each user can see. There are a few additional security options, such as keeping networks that have patient information separate from the internet, so they're offline and protected from online attacks. So that's one great way. Another option is to implement policies that prevent standard users from installing their own software, which may contain malware, as I mentioned earlier. So if they're unable to download software or click on links in their emails that may lead to the inadvertent download of malware, that's ideal. Wearables and other sensors are digital tools being incorporated into digital healthcare, but there are some concerns around them as well. So wearable sensors, such as those found in fitness bands or smartphones, they can gather continuous, passive, and objective data on behavior outside of the clinic, which is wonderful because this is the first time we're getting these comprehensive data sets of human health and behavior. So they can be used for clinical assessments of disease symptoms, treatment effects, and hopefully, eventually, in prediction of illness. But these sensors may be prone to accidental or even deliberate exposure of patient information through design flaws and attacks from outside parties. For example, outside parties may be able to eavesdrop on signals that are traveling from the sensor to a health network. Another concern is that HIPAA's data privacy rules may not apply to entities that collect health information from mobile apps or sensors. So remember a few slides back, I mentioned that HIPAA only applies to certain entities that are defined as covered entities. And many commercial companies making these wearables don't fall into those categories. Many times in these companies, it is unclear to what extent shared data are anonymized or how sharing data impacts users' privacy. You would have to read the terms of service and privacy policies of each of the devices and services to see exactly what their policies are. It's unclear whether patients and users are aware of these issues. A recent systematic review found that most articles on sensor capture of patient information for care or well-being did not report participants' views on privacy. This may raise concerns about patient acceptance and awareness of privacy policies. So one study did show that participants would opt to provide less information for commercial sensors versus sensors that were used as university study tools if given the option. highlighting the fact that they do have opinions about privacy, but the way that privacy is handled by these devices and services greatly varies and is usually not easy to understand. One suggested way to address this is to implement easy to understand patient consent. Patient consent should be obtained when using data from wearable health technologies. This would include having a consent notice that should define what personal information is collected, how often information is collected, to what parties the information is disclosed, and in what format it is disclosed. If health systems are using the devices, they should ensure that devices are connected to a secure network, and they should monitor the health system data network continuously for breaches. One possible solution to prioritize data privacy is for health systems to have a secure network for wearable devices that, again, is separate from the main network. Also, device communication should be encrypted and confidentiality should be ensured. Similar to wearables and sensors, smartphone apps are great tools and can be used to support treatment of mental health. They can use, for example, cognitive behavioral therapy-based interventions to reduce depressive symptoms and to help users be more aware of their emotional state. But just like wearables, certain smartphone apps may not respect the privacy of personal health information and may be able to collect and sell user information. In a review of 116 mobile apps for the treatment of depression, about 50% had no privacy policy available. And those that did only provided it after already collecting information on users. Further, many policies were determined to lack information regarding data encryption and password protection, and many were difficult to understand. Again, they don't make it easy for users to assess how the device and service is addressing the security and privacy of personal health information. To assist with choosing apps, the APA developed a five-step model for the assessment of mobile apps, which includes a step for assessing risks of an app relating to privacy and security. So some of the considerations include, does the app have a privacy policy? What data are collected? Can the user opt out of data collection or request that the data be deleted? Are any data shared and with what parties? Are data stored on the device or on a web server? Are personal data de-identified? And what security measures are present and are stored data encrypted? Does the app claim to be compliant with HIPAA is also a really important question, as it's often not clear. A lack of answers to many of these questions may indicate that the app has privacy and security risks that make it unsuitable for use. This will greatly help wade through and narrow down the options for apps for telemental health. So in conclusion, digital health can have great potential in not only expanding access to care for patients, but also helping us understand the comprehensive view of human health. It allows us to collect this naturalistic and continuous data sets that we were never able to collect before. But before it is widely implemented and accepted, patient information needs to be protected. The APA and ATA guidelines are a good starting point with their key considerations for privacy and security in telepsychiatry. In regards to security, there are different levels of responsibility, though, as I've mentioned, both with the organizations as well as with individual users. So, for example, network encryption is an organizational level protection, whereas passwords are important for users. So there's multiple levels. Turning to wearables and apps, it's not always clear what data is collected and how it's treated in regard to privacy and security. So patients need to be notified about this, and ideally a consent notice is one great option. But since many wearables and apps have not implemented these consent notices, the APA's app assessment guide can help weigh the risks and benefits of mobile health apps. It can also be used with wearable sensors as well. And on a broader policy level, HIPAA alone does not appear to be sufficient to protect health information collected by non-covered entities, such as these commercial entities releasing apps and wearables. So new laws are needed to regulate the collection and exchange of this information.
Thank you, Dr. Sabani, for your time. And thank you, community, for your continued support. Have a great day.